Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your invitation. I'm glad to be there and here and there. That's thanks to the technology. So not to waste time, let me start. Let me start my talk. Control L. Control L. So the title is Enriching IFS Fractals with Symmetry. Maybe about this picture a little bit, because I can't be in India, you can't be in Poland, but it's a tower in Poland, in Toruń. Toruń is a medieval city, so there are some buildings to see and visit Toruń. And this building, if you look carefully, you'll see that the person is skewed. But it's, if you look more carefully, you will see the plate, it's also skewed. And also other stuff is skewed. So the fact is that they are not skewed. That actually the tower is not vertical. It's just made up because of position of photographer. So you can check on Google Maps, Google Street View, that indeed this skew tower is indeed skew. It's not tower in Pisa, it's tower in Toruń in Poland. Toruń is a town where Copernicus was born. And okay, so the short program, IFSS, for IFSS to formulate the definition of Hutchinson attractor, I need Hausdorff metric. Then I will recall what's called chaos game algorithm. I will present an example, motivating example, which is Sierpinski triangle, which is encoded only by two maps. We need only two maps. And we are going to explain this phenomenon. And the main part of the talk is about exploring this phenomenon. We will need Kuratowski limits instead of Hausdorff limits. We will recall the theory of Lasso-Tamayak semi-attractors. The main point is enriching regular IFSS with isometry, the set isometry. And then we will go back to attractors and we will see how it is going on from the perspective of chaos game. So, standard things, X is a metric space, Fi from X to X is are continuous functions. A collection of continuous functions acting on metric space will be called iterated function system. Actually, further we will consider also topological spaces. We'll allow, maybe not today, but in general, it's important to allow also for non-metric spaces. The Hutchinson operator is acting on sets, and in this way that it takes each map takes a set, and we collect them together, we glue them together, like in puzzle or tilings. And then we can define a basic object. One of the basic objects is its invariant set. And the idea of this operator is that it describes in an abstract way how the system of maps shrinks down the whole set into pieces and glues them together to recover that set. It's kind of generalized tiling because we allow for overlap. And this is this invariance is often called self-similarity, especially if we talk about similitudes in a geometric way. A non-empty closed set A is an attractor of the IFS, provided that iterates of set S, Fn of S, converge to A with respect to the Hausdorff metric for all non-empty, closed, and bounded sets. In the seminal paper by Hutchinson, it was somewhere omitted this boundedness, and then a couple of years ago, Hutchinson has rewritten his paper again, fixing all those small typos and small errors. Anyway, it's a legendary mistake because everybody knew that you need to take closed and bounded subsets. non-empty. And the properties are like invariance. So the set is attractor is subsimilar. It's also unique among all invariant sets, which are non-empty, closed and bounded. And as a bonus, we get that A is compact. For infinite systems, it's not the case. So if you consider infinite systems, you have you may have non-compact attractors. And if X is complete metric space, the standard theorem, famous theorem by Hutchinson, states that if F comprises Banach contractions, nowadays you can consider more general contractions, then F admits an attractor. And the reasoning is standard. You have to check that F, which acts on non-empty, closed and bounded subsets of X, is a Banach contraction with respect to the Hausdorff metric. Okay. And of course, when you have to teach students, you have to do something on calculus. You can calculate derivatives. You can do various other things. So here is a link. And you can do some calculations around metrics, around Hausdorff metrics. So it's stuff for teaching to explore. There is also some GeoGebra activity because Hausdorff metric has nice interpretation. So let me maybe omit this part. You can always click. I will allow those slides later. I'll allow them for your own exploration. And okay, let me recall what's the chaos game. We are especially interested in the randomized version of the chaos game. It goes as follows. If we have an IFS of contractions, and if you have an attractor, so usually you assume that X is complete, otherwise outside of attractor, the space does not need to be complete, but usually you assume that all those contractions act on complete space. If you have an attractor, you would like to recover it, not by iterations of the Hutchinson operator, but some way of numerical way, by iterations, by single orbits. And the algorithm is like this. You start at some point in X, in the phase space X, and you iterate, you start to iterate. That is, Xn is an image of xn minus 1 according to the action of the map FIN and how to choose those FIN maps. And standard theory states that you usually have to run some stochastic process. But this time it's enough, it turns out that it's enough to run some deterministic sequences which are qualitatively random, in the sense of algorithmic randomness studied in computer science, abstract computer science. And if IN is disjunctive, which means that it contains every possible finite word, then the set of accumulation points of an orbit coincides with that attractor. That's this equality. And let me repeat, disjunctiveness is just a naive way to think about randomness, childish way, because what if you ask kid what is random, what is chaotic, it and you can expect that one of those educated guesses will be that everything can happen, and that everything can happen is here described as the sequence, disjunctive sequence, contains every possible finite word. So every combination of events is possible and actually happens. So it's a naive way of thinking about randomness. We know that true randomness does not have this feature, but it's important here to be like that. So if the driving sequence in the iteration, if we choose maps in a disjunctive way, the driving sequence is disjunctive, then the attractor can be recovered by the means of accumulation points. Of course, in practice, you stop at some point and just cut since we have at hand the contractions, we can do the trick that we wait until we get in close enough to the attractor and then start the chaos game. And it will converge quite quickly for contractive maps, depending on the largest Lipschitz constant. And of course, you could start inside, then the orbit will fill densely that attractor. But if attractor is very thin, such a theorem would be quite useless, not robust, because you would have to pick exactly the point at the very thin attractor. Imagine the Banach theorem, and that you will have iteration which has to start on the fixed point. That will be useless. So this is important that you can start actually outside an attractor and draw some rough picture of it. Okay, so we have Hutchinson attractor. We know that we can draw them. And here is an example. Very naive. It's modeled on the Champernon's idea. Champernon was a French, I think, French economist, but he has also input in mathematics. If we see that to get this Champernon sequence, we write one letter words. In case of alphabet 1, 2, it is 1 and 2. Then 2 letter words, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2. 3 letter words, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, etc. And we have to forget that they were glued. So we have actual sequence of symbols is 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, etc. And on the other way, this sequence did not appear to answer the question how one can construct this disjunctive sequence. Rather, it appeared with respect to the question of normality, because we know that normal numbers are quite abundant, but it's a probabilistic proof. So the question was, could you please pick up any number and say, oh, it's not on a normal number. So this one is normal with respect to the base 2. If we put 0 and then put dot, and we treat it as a digital expansion with respect to 1 and 2. I mean, let us interpret 2 as 0, so we will have binary expansion, okay? So it's an example of normal sequence. But disjunctive sequences can be non-normal. I mean, if you have a good sequence, you can always put some arbitrary long trash sequence, which does not help anyway, but you can put in between various sequences and prolong this good sequence. So you can diffuse frequencies of the symbols and still the sequence will be disjunctive. And what's interesting, we know that disjunctive sequence recovers attractor, but usually you do it by probabilistic means. So we can consider a very general kind of chain. It's called a chain with complete connections. And if you warrant that, regardless of the history, the probabilities are suitably positive for appearing a new symbol, then everything's fine. In another way, you can say that if the probability of the sequence of exams is not dropping too much, here are the decays of the probability allowed. So if the probability does not drop too quickly, then you can pass an arbitrary sequence of exams. And the sequence is important, the order of the sequence is important. And in practice, think of driving license. First, you have to pass theoretical exam. Then you can pass. Then you can try to pass the practical exam on driving. So driving license is two-letter word to be present in such experiment, non-stationary experiment, because this process is non-stationary. So if the probability is not dropping too much, for instance, it's constant, then it's okay. The sequence generates almost surely a disjunctive sequence of outcomes. So you see the events which actually happen, and it will turn out that with probability one, the sequence will be disjunctive. So any finite sequence will be present in that rich sequence, disjunctive sequence. Now, of course, you can allow for some drop, but not too fast. I mean, 1 over n is too quick decay. You have to be visibly above 1 over n, 1 over polynomial. And if you have, but you can allow for 1 over log n. So logarithmic decay is okay. It's not too fast, so you can pass a sequence of exams. Counterexamples, it's double I, it should be one I. I mean, pairwise independent, independently distributed. Yeah, pairwise independently distributed. If you have IID, which is identically independently distributed, it's a kind of Bernoulli process. So you have no conditioning and it's okay. But if you have only pairwise independence, it's not okay. It's not disjunctive. It does not yield with probability one disjunctive sequences. Also Markovs, when you think of ergodic theory applied to IFSs, you think, oh, if I have a mixing process, strongly mixing process, oh, it should be okay. Ergodicity is okay. No, actually it can happen that you can have M square larger than zero, which means that M is a transition matrix for strongly mixing process. 2 by 2 matrix is enough. And still M will be not disjunctive. It will be strongly mixing but process, but not disjunctive process on the symbols. So you have to be very careful when you say that, oh, it's all ergodicity, this chaos game and things like that. You have to think carefully what is ergodic, where the process is put, not on the symbols. On symbols, if you have ergodic Markov process, it's not enough. It's an exercise here. So you have to invent some matrix. It's a good exercise for students that they will have some matrix which has zero intris, and still square of this stochastic matrix is positive. So it's a good a simple example. You put A, B, C, D, you warrant that rows sum up to one and so on. So the student can have a little bit of fun with this exercise. Pairwise independence is studied in with respect to weak sources of randomness in cryptography. They can transform the sequences into strongly enough random sequences. There are some procedures like Ulam von Neumann-Weitener and things like that. But still for us, pairwise independence is not enough to yield disjunctive sequences. Okay. And now the example. So we know now we have recalled that attractor Hutchinson attractor needs that iteration of Hutchinson operator with respect to Hausdorff metric. It's invariant set, self-similar, and it can be recovered by means of the chaos game. Also, not necessarily by probabilistic chaos game, but also by means of disjunctive chaos game, deterministic. So we have the randomized version of typical probabilistic algorithm. So imagine now that you have 3 points, just like here, yeah, these third roots of unity. And we can encode this Sierpinski triangle by means of 3 maps. One is pushing this triangle into a smaller triangle with edge with the vertex here at 1. And 2 other maps are responsible for those other 2 smaller copies. And if you take union, you get again a whole triangle. So you can shrink down by 3 maps, this triangle to 3 copies. And it's a standard example, kind of boring. Now imagine that you have only one map, that map which is shrinking the whole triangle into this triangle. If you repeat, you will see that it's again shrinked here, here, here. So everything gets shrinked down to one point, 1, 0, the third root of unity one. Okay, but now imagine, since you have here a kind of rotative symmetry, you can add here isometry, 120 degrees about 0.00, counterclockwise. So you rotate this point here, and this point here. So g to the power 3 is identity. It's or isometry of order 3, periodic isometry. And now imagine that to this single map you add this rotation. So you have enriched that very poor system with one point attractor. You add rotation. And if you play the chaos game, you will see again for that smaller system, F1 and G, which has only two maps, you will again see the same effect that the chaos game draws you Sierpinski triangle. And initially, this kind of phenomena were explored by Barnsley and Elton in 1988, and they have employed the theory of Markov operators. So they state that in our case, that the system is not contractive because G is isometric, so it's not contractive map. In our case, we have average contractivity. So Lipschitz constants weighted by probabilities yield an average which is smaller than one. Of course, you have to adjust those probabilities. It's another nice example that you can try to adjust those the region of parameters allowed here to yield this average contractivity. And then it turns out that the Markov operator is asymptotically stable, and you can use ergodic theory of Markov operators. And the measure which is invariant for the Markov operator, unique, and attracts other measures in the weak convergence of measures, it turns out that measure has a support which is that triangle. But since these probabilities can be taken quite arbitrarily in a restricted region, but you can change those probabilities in various ways, and still the measure is different, but still it's the same support, the triangle. So something is going on here. Something more is, this example has something more to offer than simply that, oh, we have a Markov operator and this is just a support of that operator, of that measure, which is invariant for Markov operator. So we have something more to explain, and we will do that. Really need to, for explanation, we will need the notion of Kuratowski pi level limits. Lower topology, suppose we have a sequence of sets Sn in space X, and the lower topological limit is a set of points which are limits to sequences across the sequence Sn. Xn is taken in Sn. So we have a sequence Xn across the sequence Sn, and we take all limits. If we instead take accumulation points of those sequences across Sn, so we take limits of subsequences, then we have upper topological limit. Of course, upper topological limit is larger than lower topological limit. And if they coincide, we say that we actually have Kuratowski limit. It's important to note that those limits are closed, and we also have some properties. For instance, it's kind of exercises here. For instance, the upper topological limit answers you an ancient question, what the union lacks to become a closed union. It lacks upper topological limit of the sequence SN. So it's the thing which lacks the union to be a closed union. Okay, so we have another a new notion of convergence concurrent to Hausdorff. And here is some comparison. It's a lot of things written here. You see that it's again kind of exercises. It's taken from the book by Beer. Suppose we have a complete metric space, and suppose we have a sequence of compact sets. Usually we are interested in compact sets when we talk about iterative function systems. And suppose we have set S which is closed. And now we consider three kinds of convergence. For us important is Hausdorff and Kuratowski, but for comparison to have a greater picture, I include also Vietoris. So we can think that SN is sequence of compact sets, SN is convergent to S with respect to Hausdorff distance. SN is convergent to S in the Vietoris topology. And we can also consider Kuratowski limit that SN has a limit, Kuratowski limit, which is equal to S. And as you see in those properties, if S is compact, the limit of a sequence is supposed to be compact. If we assume that it's compact, then Hausdorff and Vietoris are the same. Vietoris is needed mainly if you want to go outside metric spaces into the realm of topological spaces. But Kuratowski limits, which I have introduced here, is a weaker concept. Hausdorff convergence implies Kuratowski convergence, but not the other way around. When they coincide? They coincide if the closed union of Sn is compact. In other words, if we assume that Sn and S all lie in a common compact space, then it does not matter which kind of definition of convergence of sets we choose, Hausdorff, Vietoris, or Kuratowski. And these are some peculiarities of this convergence, because for Hausdorff, we have very strong properties. If sets SN are compact, then S, the limit in the Hausdorff metric, is also compact, and the closed union is also compact. So for Hausdorff convergence, we don't see all those peculiarities about closed union being compact and so on. We have it for free. When we come to Vietoris, it turns out that the limit may be non-compact, but it is compact if and only if the closed union of sets is compact. And Kuratowski is very strange. I mean, how to warrant that the limit in Kuratowski sense is compact? We have Sn compact sets, and how to warrant that S is also compact? You need to assume that Sn, all Sn's lie in a common compact set. Then the limit will be also compact. So you need to assume that Sn's are lying in some compact subspace. So the following phenomenon can happen, that Sn's are compact, the Kuratowski limit is also compact, but the closed union is not compact. So the convergence, if we think of the closed union, the convergence actually takes place outside a compact realm. Of course, we don't see it because we just test a sequence of compact sets and the limit is also compact. We can pretend that we work in compact space. But if we take the closed union, we actually, in a sense, we are exploring a non-compact space. So this is a kind of warning that we can think that Kuratowski is the same as Hausdorff with a little bit of caution. And I would like to dedicate this talk to a reviewer of my PhD, Professor Dr. Habilitowany Inżynier Józef Myjak, who quite recently has passed away. Yeah, it is in some small city in Abruzzo region in Italy, and this was abandoned city. I mean, people lived there and they have left this town. And there are very small entrance because the city had to defend against invaders in ancient times. Now the main notion of this exploration, semi-attractor, a non-empty closed set is a semi-attractor of the IFS, provided that the intersection of lower limits of Fn over X is that set A flat. In other words, an IFS admits a semi-attractor if this intersection is non-empty. If this intersection is non-empty, we call it a semi-attractor. It's kind of strange definition, so let me explain it with properties that it's a very good definition. First, it's invariant set. A flat semi-attractor is invariant. We don't have uniqueness. Uniqueness is for Hutchinson attractors. Here we don't have uniqueness. But instead of that, we have that semi-attractor is the smallest invariant set. So maybe there are lots of other invariant sets, but this one is the smallest one. So any invariant set contains a semi-attractor. So this is a substitute for minimality. And what about semi-attractivity? Because we have semi-attractor. How those sets are attracted in this case by the semi-attractor? So we say that we have that property that lower topological limits of Fn of S contain a semi-attractor. It does not look strong, but in other words, if we look at all the things, we see that actually it states that A flat is an intersection of all lower limits of Fn over S. Because one could ask, okay, why we choose only points? Why not all sets? So the answer is yes, we could actually assume a stronger type of definition that the intersection of Fn of S of lower limits of Fn of S over all non-empty subsets is equal to A flat. But then you will see that it's again like taking just singletons. And singletons is easier to check than all subsets. And what about self-regeneration or inner attractivity? Because we would like to have some attractivity. And indeed, inside, if we start with any set S inside the semi-attractor, which is S is non-empty, then the Kuratowski limit of Fn of S is exactly A flat. So you can imagine that if you have a semi-attractor, if you take only part of that semi-attractor, then you can grow that part to the whole semi-attractor. It's self-regeneration. Every part of semi-attractor regenerates to the whole semi-attractor. That's how it was put by Myjak and Lasota in their own words, because it's hard to find this in formal mathematical papers, but it was the way they thought about this property. Let's say self-regeneration. So we have here convergence instead of Hausdorff, we have Kuratowski convergence here. So we have attraction, but only inside and a semi-attractor. Outside semi-attractor, quirky things can happen. it's semi-attractivity only. And now I have not assumed that the semi-attractor is compact. Hutchinson attractor of finite iterated function system is always compact, but finite iterated function system can yield unbounded semi-attractor. So imagine you have 8 maps which encode in Sierpinski triangle, which is, this one is quite visible, but it's about this one, yeah? So we have 8 parts. Inside you have empty. So those maps shrink the whole thing into 8 copies. It's standard encoding of the Sierpinski carpet. Now imagine that you add 2 additional maps, which are isometries, G and H. 2 translations. One is translation, G is translating here, H is translating here. And you can imagine that if you follow this G and H combination, you can get from here like that and here. Yeah. So it turns out that the system F1, F8, enriched by those 2 translations, yields this quarter infinite Sierpinski triangle. So you can have infinite carpets in theory of in the theory of Lasota and Mayak. And you can treat it as a kind of exercise for students, but you can encode also quarter infinite Sierpinski chessboard. Chessboard is that you have, you know, those things with are, some parts are like black and some parts are like white, like in chessboard. So you can think about designing a suitable IFS to encode Sierpinski chessboard. They if you have bad day, you can look actually in their paper and look how they did it. And this one is a quite ugly picture of this carpet because the iteration is not adjusted. It's rough, it's raw experiment. I mean, you just take the Bruin sequence on cycle over alphabet with 10 letters, and you warrant that all words up to length 5 are appearing in that sequence, and you want as short sequence as possible. So you build it around the Bruin cycle. And it turns out that this orbit is 100 points. 100,000 points. So this is the truth about attractors. They are not always so nice. You have to work on them to adjust iteration to produce nice pictures. And another thing is a warning. Okay, we know that semi-attractors, unlike Hutchinson attractor, can be also unbounded. Another information, somehow bad information, is that you cannot draw semi-attractors by means of Gauss game. It's kind of zonk. I mean, previously I have already shown you that I did it by means of Gauss game, and now I claim that usually you cannot do it. It's forbidden. Let me show you this example. We have a halving map and doubling map, which doubles points on the real line. It's easy to see that 0 is invariant because it's fixed point of those 2 maps. You can check directly how the iteration of the Hutchinson operator behaves to conclude that indeed A flat is equal 0 is semi-attractor of F. And now why in general the Gauss game fails to recover semi-attractor. Imagine that you start on point X, 2 to the power 0 X, and you can either double, which will lead you to 2 to the power 1 X, or you can halve the point, which is 2 to the power minus 1 X. So if you consider powers, you have something like random walk on the integer lattice. So it's kind of standard random walk. And if you recall some basic facts, you know that with probability 1, if 2 to power zx is home of drunkard, then the guy with probability 1/2, with 50% of probability walks left and he walks right with 50% of probability, and with probability 1 he will always return to his home. Maybe the average waiting time will be infinite, but still with probability 1 the drunkard will go back home just by mixing those two maps with probability 50-50. So the process returns to initial position infinitely often. So initial position will always be present in the set of accumulation points of an orbit with probability 1. But that x different from 0 is not in semi-attractor. So you will always get an artifact by playing the chaos game, regardless how far you cut the game. You restart the game, you will always get this with probability 1. So in general, chaos game fails for semi-attractors. Now the Lasota-Mayak criterion is this criterion states that semi-attractors are more flexible than Hutchinson attractors. For Hutchinson attractors, actually, you have to assume that something is contractive, or you have to work by hand to check that some very specific example leads to an attractor. And here, if you know some attractor or semi-attractor, say for some sub-IFS FJ with J in J, where J is a subset of indices in I. If some sub-IFS admits a semi-attractor, call it AJ, then the whole system also admits a semi-attractor, A-flat, call it a flat. And then it turns out that it can be recovered. It's kind of self-regeneration, but this time we built in thin air. I mean, previously we had that we already have a semi-attractor, and from each part of it we can grow this semi-attractor. That was self-regeneration. This time we have the other way around. I mean, we don't have a semi-attractor, but if we have that AJ, which is called nucleus, then we can grow attractor, semi-attractor out of thin air. It's given by this kind of, let's call it geometric series formula. AJ union F of AJ union F square of AJ, F cube of AJ, and so on. Or if you prefer, you can take Kuratowski limit of AJ, Fn of AJ, and you can grow this semi-attractor. So you can grow from some good subsystem, you can grow a semi-attractor of the larger system. So if some subsystem is good, then the whole system is good. It also needs a semi-attractor. And that the semi-attractor of the smaller system is called a nucleus for the larger one. Core nucleus. Okay, so let's go back to this enrichment phenomenon. We had only one contraction, we have added some rotation, and voila, we had Sierpinski triangle. So let's start to investigate more thoroughly. Suppose X is a proper metric space. Proper means that closed and bounded sets are compact. Suppose F is a contractive IFS with an attractor AF, and suppose we have some periodic surjective isometry. And we suppose that this isometry, unlike translations, this isometry admits a fixed point. It's not necessarily unique, but it has to admit a fixed point. So rotation is okay, translation is not okay. Symmetry with respect to axis is okay. It has several fixed points, more than one. So fixed point is not unique. That's Hallmark instances, as you saw before, in that case of Sierpinski triangle rotated, that X is Euclidean space and G may be rational rotation. So the proposition is this: if we have this enriched system, F was system with attractor, and now we add this one isometry. Then it turns out that this larger system admits a semi-attractor, A flat, and that semi-attractor is compact, so it's not unbounded, it's compact, it's good, and it's G-symmetric. So it has the designed symmetry. So if we want some symmetry in the attractor, in the semi-attractor, we can add the map describing this symmetry. And the proof is by just by application of this Lasota-Meyer criterion, which shows that semi-attractors are ubiquitous. You just take an attractor of smaller IFS to be the nucleus for the larger one, and voila, you have it. Lasota-Meyer criterion yields you that semi-attractor. Now you have to check that it's compact, it's G-symmetric. Mainly it's Lasota-Meyer criterion. And okay, it's just a proposition. So from that perspective, you have that that Sierpinski triangle was okay, reproduced as not only as a invariant, as a support of invariant measure by adding rotation, but also by it is just a semi-attractor. That's the secret behind the construction. Okay, let's see another example. Instead of triangle, we have pentagon. So again, we can have five maps and then code it by five maps here. One map will shrink down this pentagon to this pentagon, the other one to this. One, two, three, four, five. So we would have, we would need to have five maps, contractive IFS, and this pentagon will be an attractor of the contractive IFS. But instead of that, we can spare on the number of maps, and we can just take one map, which shrinks this whole pentagon to this, and add rotation responsible for the symmetry of this pentagonal Sierpinski set. And if we add to that one contraction, if we add rotation, then of course we don't have a contractive system, but still the semi-attractor will be that Sierpinski pentagon. Ah, here are just formulas for the fifth roots of unity. Yeah? You have fifth, you have rotational symmetry, so you need five roots of unity. So you can spare on the number of maps from five to two only. It's another example. If we go back to our Sierpinski, but we have fifth unity, fifth roots of unity, but on the xy plane. So the third coordinate is zero. And if you consider such a system, of course, you will have a Sierpinski triangle in the xy plane, despite the system acts on the Euclidean space, three-dimensional space. And again, we can consider the kind of special construction. If we add to that triangle system, we add another isometry. So we again have non-contractive IFS. This enriched IFS will have symmetry of map G. So we take 90 degree rotation about axis 0, y. And describing this in formulas is, I think, quite useless, as you get something like this. This is the effect. So you see that there are something like Sierpinski triangles, but thanks to the rotation, you get quite interesting fractal polytop or something like. It's just a visualization, of course. So we have a compact semi-attractor for the enriched system, and it has rotational symmetry, 90 degree. So So, what's more? It turns out that these semi-attractors actually are attractors. So I said, I need semi-attractors. And now I said, maybe not necessary, I can get rid of semi-attractors. But it's a theorem about that, how to do this. So suppose we have contractive IFS on proper X. Suppose we have this isometry, p-periodic surjective isometry, which admits a fixed point. So translation is not allowed. You will get some unbounded semi-attractor in this way. So on p-periodic surjective isometry needs to have at least one fixed point. And if we just enrich the system, that's the system, IFS number one, we will get the previous situation that we have added one map to the previous system. The enriched system is not contractive. It only admits a compact semi-attractor. Now suppose that we enrich the IFS F in a different way by composing maps Fi with G in various ways. So G will be like something like conjugation. We take GJ and G minus J, which is the inverse to GJ, and we compose it. So we we take something like conjugation by GJ to Fi. Another system is that we give it full freedom. We can take different number of maps G on the right, and we can take different number of maps on the left. And let's take G hat. G hat is just taking maps G outside Fi. So all systems 2, 3, and 4, which come from F by suitable composition of maps from F with isometry, those IFSs 2, 3, and 4 are contractive. So they admit Hutchinson attractors. And the theorem, recent theorem 2020, states that semi-attractor of this enriched IFS is in fact an attractor for any of those three systems. Those three systems are different formally, but they have the same attractor. And this attractor of those contractive IFSs is actually the semi-attractor of this naively enriched IFS. So despite in 80s and 90s, people have played with graphics computer programs and were producing various pictures, and they allowed for isometries. In fact, they were playing with usual attractors, but for slightly different systems. From the point of chaos game, they were producing the same stuff. And interestingly, regardless of this whole story about attractors and semi-attractors, the fourth system, this Fi composite outside with GK, was considered also in 2009 book Symmetry in Chaos by Field and Golubitsky. But they didn't mention that actually it has something to do with other systems or with semi-attractors. They are just stating that if you take these, then you will get something symmetric with respect to isometry G. And there is also a web page, a Larry Liddell, when he plays the story and states this on his web page, independently of the book. So the story is that, okay, by enriching regular IFS, we can get symmetric semi-attractor, and in fact it turns out that it's a usual attractor for suitably enriched IFS, but enriching has to be by compositions with isometry, not just by adding this. Then we get usual attractors, not semi-attractors. So everything coincides. But if you look closely, you have here a GJ, G minus J, GJ, GK, GK from outside. What about GJ from inside, without outside? That's another interesting question. And the answer is this. If we take contractive IFS, this isometry, this symmetric enrichment, we could enrich it in the usual way, or we can consider this G tilde system, which is composing maps Fi inside with GJ. And what happens is that, of course, a flat semi-attractor of F tilde exists. F as contractive system admits an attractor. And between attractor of F and semi-attractor of F tilde, there exists something which is a semi-attractor of this G tilde system. So unlike in Golubitsky, where the composition was outside, we take inner compositions with G. And what can be said more about this semi-attractor? Aside that it's between A flat and AF. It's symmetric in a sense. I mean, if you iterate this semi-attractor by isometry G and glue all those copies, you will recover the whole semi-attractor of the larger system of this enrichment. Moreover, it turns out that it's symmetric with respect to G if and only if AF coincides with AG flat, if and only if AG flat coincides with a flat. Yeah, so either every AG flat agrees with all, with the attractor of F and the attractor of enrichment, and it is on the same time, it is G symmetric, or it is not G symmetric and it is different from the basic attractor under an F and from that semi-attractor of the enriched system. So either we have equalities and AG tilde is G symmetric or not. None of the properties is hers. But still you can recover A flat from AG tilde from it, from that attractor by taking those copies, P copies of AG flat. Maybe picture will be better thing. So we had that pentagonal system, and if you look at the previous things, we had those four systems which yield always this pentagon, but G tilde is different. It yields only small pentagon. And you can easily imagine that if you rotate this and copy it, you will recover the whole pentagon. So here is that recovering. So you can recover semi-attractor of the enriched system as an attractor of suitable enrichment by compositions with isometry, or if the composition is done in a wrong way, you have still to copy it. And this is the effect if we consider this rotation about OY axis of the Sierpinski triangle in 3D. So we have in plane O, in XY plane, we have Sierpinski and we rotate. We allow for rotation, 90 degree rotation. And the small semi-attractor will be that on the left. And four iterations, four copies of this glue up to this semi-attractor of enrichment. It can be drawn, this kind of pictures can be drawn by means of the IFS style program written by Mehonsev to study tilings, fractal tilings. Is it the end? Well, we can ask for chaos gain. So we have this F, we have enrichment of F by isometry, and we can ask about playing the chaos game. Of course, you could play the chaos game for those attractors of associated contractive IFSs, where G was composite with Fs. But we would like to ask whether we can play directly the chaos game, especially in view that of the fact that in 80s and 90s, people were getting some images by means of chaos game, and they didn't know that it's actually an attractor or semi-attractor of suitable IFS. So it turns out that we can play either probabilistic or randomized chaos game with any of the contractive IFSs. That's because of the theorem on coincidence. We can play probabilistic chaos game directly for F. We take F tilde and we can play just like people did it in the 80s. And with probability one, we will get the effect. That was the reason why Lasota and Mayak introduced those semi-attractors. They were wondering why people are getting some pictures and it's legit and what happens then. Because they pursue further of the explanation of by Barnsley and Elton, because Barnsley and Elton had to use those measures, and actually Lasota Mayak were seeing that we have actually some pictures, so maybe something about sets, and their answer was that semi-attractor concept. And what about the randomized chaos game? And indeed, we can play the randomized chaos game directly with F tilde. Fitzsimmons and Kunze have also considered general IFSs. And from their observation, it follows that indeed we can play a randomized chaos game. For they were rather interested in more general IFSs, very general theory on topological spaces. And their proof is does not allow for some insight in the story. It's valid, but it's not explaining what happens. So I would like to slightly to look a little bit closer on this phenomenon of getting by means of chaos game, semi-attractors, directly from the enriched system. So we have F, and F, and maps in F are enumerated by letters I in the alphabet I, in the finite alphabet I. And it's a contractive IFS on proper metric space X. And then we add another map, G, isometry. P-periodic surjective isometry, which admits a fixed point. And we will look how it is possible that the randomized chaos game works directly for F tilde. So no cheating, like taking a modified IFS, which is contractive and its attractor coincide with semi-attractor, but directly we will get semi-attractor. Why it is so? So we can deduce it from the chaos game, from one of those systems, by the reduce and transcribe procedures. So let us add to this alphabet I for system F, another letter, call it G, like isometry G. The letter is called the same. So it's the alphabet for F tilde. And it turns out that we can carefully transcribe disjunctive sequences over this alphabet I union J to disjunctive sequences over this complicated alphabet, which are ZP, I, and ZP. So they encode this complicated, it's like building Chinese signs. You build it from parts into one symbol. So the symbol is here like that. GK composite with Fi, composite with G, J. It's one symbol. It's considered to one symbol, to be one symbol. And we have to transcribe from the words from the alphabet I and reach it with J, G to this complicated alphabet. And we have to also to consider that there are some reductions. Otherwise, the orbits over one alphabet would not translate directly to orbits over another alphabet. So instead of those reduction and transcription algorithms, which can be detailed, let's see what can go wrong. So we have to, once again, we have to rewrite from this alphabet I union G to the alphabet ZP cyclic P group, yeah, times I times cyclic P group, which encodes the maps in GF. Okay, so if we play the chaos game, we have some kind of this effect that sometimes we have drawn map G several times. Sometimes we will get some map F in F and not enriched system. And we can look from the right to the left and hunt for the occurrences of clear maps from F, not enriched F. And those occurrences are separated by blocks of G. And this is how the typical orbit will look like, unless some degenerate cases, but the sequence has to be okay because we consider it is already disjunctive over this alphabet, I union G. So no degeneracies can occur. So FIN, once again, is the nth occurrence of a map from I, from this not enriched system. And G are those enrichments. And those blocks are denoted gamma N minus one. And how to rewrite it into this complicated alphabet? ZP times I times ZP. You have to consider reductions. But if you will be very eager to reduce everything, like waving your sword everywhere, you can get into trouble because you will cut off too much. I mean, do not reduce too much. That's the first advice. The reduction when you transcribe it into another alphabet. And here is the case. Suppose you have something like G3, some part of this of the original chaos game for F tilde looks like this. G3, third occurrence of map from F, pure F, no tilde, pure F, third occurrence. Then you have GP minus one, and then you have GP minus one. So the block is actually two times pi minus one, the whole block here of gamma, the whole block gamma is here, but it's suggestively split. And then you have fourth occurrence of the map from F, and you have again symbols from G and so on and so on. So if you reduce it, yeah, because you may have too many maps to rewrite it into a suitable alphabet, this block can be too long to interpret it over this alphabet ZP times I times ZP. So you have to reduce it. But if you would reduce it too much, suppose you did it like that, it's okay. But you can see that pi minus two could be still reduced sometimes. So if you do it, you have to refrain from doing the last possible reduction, or you will get something like this. You see, if you reduce it too much, then you will get that this letter, this complicated letter, and this complicated letter will not appear after the transcription. So we will lose some letters. And the orbit after transcription will no longer be disjunctive over this new alphabet. So if you reduce it too much, yeah, you could have, you see that you have pi minus one, pi minus one, which is two pi minus two. And if you would reduce it too much by p, then you will lose this occurrence. So you have to refrain from the final possible reduction. That's the main message. Otherwise, some letters will not, some neighboring letters will be not present in after transcription if you reduce too much. So this is the first warning. That's the first obstacle, just to rewrite the word from one alphabet to another alphabet. You know that in usual, in normal language also, it's not always one-to-one correspondence when rewriting words from one to another alphabet. And what can go wrong? So we have this chaos game orbit for F tilde. We want to interpret it somehow as a chaos game orbit over GF. And we would like to see that it, if the chaos game orbit over F tilde would be still disjunctive over GF. So what about transcription? You cannot just transcribe everything in a simple way. You have to vary splitting of G blocks. So in previous slide, I have suggested some splitting, but in fact, we should be more careful with splitting. I mean, here we have, let's go from right to left. F, fifth occurrence of F, it's actually F1 map. Then we have G5. Five times was G drone. Then we have F1 again on the six. The sixth occurrence of the map of from F is again F1. Then we have G5. The seventh occurrence of map from F is again F1. Then we have again G5. So we have kind of triviality, but we cannot say, oh, let's split it always like G2, G3, or G1, G4. We have to vary this splitting in a careful, very carefully, or the block will always be divided in one way. So here is a, here is some message to bear in mind that if we have G5 here, glue it. So here we have empty block on the right of F1. Then we have a G4, G1 split it. And G4, G1, you think that it's the same splitting, but think of neighbors of F1. In one case is G1, G4, and in other case is G1, G4, 5. So varying splitting of G blocks does not simply mean that you have always to divide it differently. You have to also to look what already happened in previous times. So, and here we have F1 with two neighbors, G2, G4. And G3 waits for some other gluing with another occurrence of symbol from F. So it's this splitting is not only, does not only mean that you just cannot, that you have to be careful with splitting always G1, G4, G1, G4, G1, G4, but also you have to look what was happening earlier. So it's not just as simple that vary splitting of G blocks. With respect to splitting a concrete block and with respect to neighboring blocks. If they are split in some way, then you have to split the middle block also in a specific way. So these are those precautions. And okay, suppose you have reduced and transcribed, but how could you see that actually after proper transcription and reduction, you'll have disjunctive sequence of a new alphabet? So you have to imagine that you hunt for some word. It is a word six is neighbored by two other maps, Fi star from the left and from the right. You hunt in this transcribed word over alphabet GF, you hunt for this word GKT composite with FIT composite with GJT. So it's, you see that it's a word in this strange alphabet. I have warned you that you have to take ZP, IZP. So here you have GKT, FIT, and GJT. But to hunt for those words in the resulting sequence, you need some markers, just like in DNA study of transcription and things like that. So it's kind of similar to DNA theory. Not very naive, of course, analogy, but you have to have those markers. Those markers will allow you to find those words which you actually need to find to ensure that the new transcribed word over this new alphabet GF is actually disjunctive. So, and another complication, if it's not enough to fix KT, IT, and JT, because different configurations, KT, IT, JT, yield equal words. So it's kind of redundancy still. And you need, so you need markers, you have a redundancy, but then you will find that all words actually appear in this transcribed, this transcribed infinite sequence over a new alphabet. So it's quite complicated. Fortunately, there is another proof. I will not show you that. It's much simpler, but it does not unveil any true story. I mean, it's just a proof, brutal proof. As you want to sort of prove, you can have a one. But this proof shows you that actually the whole algebra of words, which is studied in computer science and in algebra, is quite interesting on its own, regardless of being applied to chaos game dynamics. And so the marriage of symbolic dynamics with automata, with iterated function systems, I think will be continued in various ways on various perspectives. And here are only some reminders that what was good about semi-attractor theory? It was easy to ensure that actually the system has a semi-attractor. Look at this system. We have a topology sign, and we can, and Shivak and some other people also have built some map which has a dense orbit. If we add to this special map projection onto the point from which starts dense orbit, then we can have an IFS which has an attractor, but you have to check that it is attractor. Of course, it's not hard this time, but you already, by seeing that, oh, here we have zero Lipschitz map, which is contractive, it's constant map. You already know that regardless what you put as F1, there will be some semi-attractor. So for semi-attractors, it's easier, it's more ubiquitous notion. But it's not always the case. So the interest point in this attractor is, of course, that it's connected, but not arcwise connected and not locally connected. In the standard theory, you know that Hatta have proved that if an attractor of contractive IFS is connected, then it is necessarily locally connected and arcwise connected. It's always. But if you go outside the rim of contractive systems, it's no longer the case. So that's the point of this. And you can assume also two identity and irrational rotation. And if you have irrational rotation and identity on the on the circle. You can make an abstract point from this. You can take X compact, you can take minimal map, and you have a general case. But in particular, you can take a circle and irrational rotation on it, and you can add identity. And it turns out that this system admits an attractor. We can check it by hand. And unfortunately, even theory of semi-attractors is helpless here. You don't have any a subsystem admitting a semi-attractor. Actually, you can prove that neither identity nor minimal map itself as a subsystem admits a semi-attractor. So Lasota-Meyer criterion is helpless here. Despite it was so nice and worked on several occasions, this time not. And still the problem exists that we have lack of existence criteria for attractors. So even if we make some trade-off and allow for semi-attractors, still there are some systems where it's hard to assist whether they have attractor or semi-attractor. So, and you can generalize also some observation in this way that if you have a contractive IFS on compact metric space, you can build not nice IFS, which is never contractive under any circumstances, and still has an attractor. So you can break a good IFS of contractions, make it into a product, and then you get some IFS, which is not contractive, it still has an attractor. And still the problem is that you don't have any subsystem which admits semi-attractor. So lack of existence for attractors is, I think, the current problem with this whole theory. And of course, some applications are problematic in case of non-contractive IFSs, because practically all applications of iterated function systems rely on some kind of contractivity, not only because of fast convergence when you apply it to some image manipulation, but also because of various constructs like fractal transformations, which also rely on some contractivity, which allows for addressing structure in the attractor. So at the moment, the theory of non-contractive IFSs has two main problems: lack of general existence criteria. Lasota-Meyer theory is some kind of workaround in some cases, and still there may be some link to the ordinary attractors, just like as I showed you with this enrichment theory, that we have a semi-attractor, but then if you look carefully at the story, then you find that actually those semi-attractors are attractors of specifically associated IFSs. So we have lack of existence criteria and lack of applications, to be honest. There are no serious applications for non-contractive IFSs, unless you treat as a serious application a kind of compression that instead that you can encode pentagon not with five maps, but two maps are enough. If you treat it as a kind of progressing compression theory, then okay. Then we have an application of non-contractive IFSs. Oh, hurrah, hooray. But in general, we have lack of existence criteria as a one problem, and another problem is lack of serious applications. We are just only exploring now. At the moment, we are just exploring the theory of non-contractive IFSs and trying to prove something. And to excuse me, To excuse me, I can say that not much is known about dimension already in contractive case if we allow for overlaps. And if you go to non-contractive IFS, not only dimension theory is problematic, but also lots of other stuff. This connected theory of connected sets. So we only know that sometimes attractors or semi-attractors exist, and then we have a general theorem on recovering of attractors, semi-attractors by means of chaos games. So we have some existence sometimes. Still, we don't have general criteria, and we know that we can play the chaos game to recover semi-attractor or attractor. And not much more theory is done at the moment for non-contractive IFSs. Yeah, so here you have, it's hard to get these papers. They were written rather long time ago. And this is that Barsley and Elton paper. Here is that book by Field and Golubitsky, the recent paper about Fitzsimmons and Kunze. This is the Beard book on topologies on closed and convex sets, which is a kind of compendium for hyperspace topology. And of course, everything about those enrichments is written in our paper, which is under review for many weeks. And its title is Iterated Function Systems Enriched with Symmetry. So I think that's all. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I would like to express our sincere thanks to Christoph Lesniak for giving an excellent coverage to enriching IFS fractals with symmetry. We thank for his valuable time spent with us and giving us an opportunity to take his thoughts forward. Thank you once again.
Thank you very much.
Our next session will be on tomorrow from 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. Thank you all.
Christoph.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you.